This is a Kaiser Panorama machine, one of the few working models left in the world. It's a viewing device for stereographic images. 3D pictures to you and me.
The pictures on show here capture a lost world. One of horse-drawn carriages, of elegance, ambition, sophistication. So how did this civilized, forward-looking, affluent world turn into this? Look at this picture. This is what some parts of Europe looked like after the war. A vision of hell. A place of the dead. How did this happen? Well, before the world self-destructed, it seemed to be in safe hands. Her family's hands. Queen Victoria's sons and daughters had married into Europe's greatest families. So three of the empires who would fight the war were ruled by her grandsons. That's right, the King of England, George V, the German monarch, Kaiser Wilhelm II, and the Russian Emperor, Tsar Nicholas, were all cousins. To get some background on the family firm, I spoke to Katrina Clay, author of Kaiser, King and Tsar.
I think the three cousins, if you think of them as Georgie, William, Nicky...
It's hard.
Which is hard, the King, the Kaiser and the Tsar, but if you think about them like that, they are part of this massive family, and Queen Victoria is the grandmother. And I would say they're the same as many other families. They love each other and they hate each other, you know. I mean, there's a very strong feeling in that family. And perhaps the one that really, really suffered from that was Willie. None of them liked Willie.
What was the problem with Willie?
He was taken up with his own image, is perhaps one way of putting it. You know, and if you look at the photographs of him, you know, he's absolutely standing there and he's the warlord and he's got one of his 400 uniforms on. And he is quite given to making these extraordinarily bombastic sort of statements, you know, and he calls Parliament that monkey house and all that sort of thing, you know. But actually, he was quite a split person. And underneath, I would say he was sensitive. He was craving affection and attention. He longed for his English family to love him, and they didn't.
Do you think there was a bit of empire envy going on as far as Wilhelm was concerned?
I wouldn't say a bit of empire envy, I would say a lot. I think Wilhelm's own phrase was, we want a place in the sun.
The German generals had the measure of their Kaiser. They knew he was a man easily seduced by the sound of trumpets. And while he and his country were frustrated with the few colonies they did control, the military pushed Willy to sanction a massive arms build-up to compensate for his lack of empire. There were huge investments in the army. Just look at this impressively suited and booted battalion. They also developed bigger and better artillery. And they built a navy that would rival Britain's. None of this won either the Kaiser or his country any friends. However, the rest of Europe had a plan to keep Germany in its place. No one wanted a big European war, so a number of old enemies decided to play nice and enter into treaties with one another. In 1904, Britain ended centuries of hatred towards its rivals across the Channel and signed an alliance with the French. In 1907, France and Russia agreed to jointly declare war on any nation that attacked either one of them. So pick a fight with Russia, and immediately you had to fight France as well. They hoped that would stop Germany from starting any trouble. It left the waning Austro-Hungarian Empire as Germany's only European ally. The irony was that this strategy aimed at preventing a war was the very thing that sucked us into one. I asked historian and journalist Sir Max Hastings what went wrong.
No event in history is inevitable, that nothing has to happen. But one of the things that made the First World War happen was that in 1914, everybody had come to think in Europe that war was inevitable. No one nation deserves all the blame for what happened in 1914. It was the result of a whole range of incredibly complicated issues. And one of the other problems was that in 1914, to us nowadays, a huge European war is something unthinkably dreadful. To them, they regarded war as a usable instrument of policy.
This is how it began, with the murder of the heir to the Austro-Hungarian Empire. Here's a picture of Ferdinand 4 years earlier in London, at the funeral of King Edward VII, which is why the doomed Archduke is wearing a black armband. This is his killer, a 19-year-old kid called Gavrilo Princip, a Bosnian Serb radical. The assassination of the Archduke Franz Ferdinand brought to a head a long-running dispute in the Balkans between Serbia and Austria-Hungary over territory. The old empire had uncovered a plot that linked Princip to the Serbian military. But as Russia had promised to defend Serbia from any attack, Austria-Hungary had to think very carefully about any retaliation. Of course, it also had a heavily armed, aggressive nation on its side, too. Its old ally, Germany.
I think Germany deserves more than most of the blame, because Germany was the one power that could have stopped it. If at any time during July 1914, after the assassination of the Archduke, the Germans had gone on the telephone to Vienna and said, hang on, you better not invade Serbia. This is all going to get way out of hand. We're going to have a huge war. But they didn't make that phone call. So, yes, it was an incredibly complicated mixture of forces that brought about this war. But part of the trouble was that nations were crazy enough to think they could get something out of victory, and the Germans were confident they could beat any combination of powers against them.
That confidence would push them into a war which would change the world.
With German encouragement, the Austro-Hungarian Empire declared war on Serbia on July the 28th, whereupon, one by one, countries bound by treaties and self-interest fell into war like a line of dominoes.
Within 2 days of war being declared on Serbia, Russia began marshalling its forces. Russia had yet to declare war on anyone, but the sight of it mobilising its armies was enough to force Germany's hand. And on August the 1st, Germany declared war on the Tsar, the Kaiser's cousin. 2 days after that, it declared war on Russia's ally, France. And here are the Kaiser's troops marching through Berlin on their way to war. As they left, the Kaiser told them that they would be back before the leaves had fallen from the trees. None of them could have known what lay ahead. The war they were starting would destroy this Germany.